We'd like to welcome you to Roy Leonard Rucker's 80th birthday. And as his children and grandchildren, we'd like to take a few minutes to honor him and celebrate his life. And he's going to tell us a few things about his life and how he grew up so that we can all know. First of all, Dad, where were you born and what day?
I was born June the 4th, 1923 in Mesa, Arizona. And the family lived on the Mesa Ranch School, which was at the southeast corner of Horn Lane and Southern Avenue.
What's there today?
Subdivision. Okay. Now, I've got a map made of how the ranch school was laid out. The ranch school, we called it, was a college prep course for Eastern rich dudes. Because they come out there, they pay $2,000 to $3,000 to go to school. Anyway, that takes too long. Dad worked there as a ranch foreman. And I grew up on that ranch until until I was about 14. Mother built a new house up on Southern Avenue on 35 acres. But during that time, as I was growing up on the ranch school, we had a buggy and a horse named Molly. And we'd put the milk cans in the buggy and go up to where their place was and milk cows. There was Herb and Lewis and I. We'd milk anywhere from 5 to 20 cows between us. And we'd take the milk and put it through a hand separator, get the cream out, take it out the road, and the creamy truck would pick it up. That's the way they made it, supplemented their income. Dad made $75 a month in the ranch school, but he had a house furnished, a place to raise pigs. It was a good life. During that time, I have seen the evolution of the airplane. Farm equipment, horse and buggy to big tractors, trucking, little old Model T to big trucks. In 80 years, it's been a good experience.
So when you, well, let's talk a little bit about your family first. How many brothers and sisters do you have?
Let's see, Herbert was about 10 years older than I was. Lewis was about 6 or 7, I guess, older. And then Ruth was about 3 years younger than me, and Bud, and Robert was the tail end Charlie. He came along last. They're all dead now, except me. I'm the only survivor.
So a few minutes ago, Dad, you were telling me your sign of wealth in your family. What was your sign of wealth?
I don't understand.
A radio. You were telling me about having a radio.
Well, we had a adobe house there. It started out as a 12 or 14 adobe room. Then they built a kitchen on one end, the other end, and I had a breezeway between the kitchen and the living room. And on the south side of the house, we had a screen porch, was the sleeping quarters. And we were rich because we had a radio. We had a wood stove. Majestic wood stove. We took a bath in a wash tub.
How often?
Well, at least once a week.
And was there an order of when you took a bath?
Well, the little kids were first, and the big kids slept in there, washed them in the big group later on when dirt water got dirty. But then along there, Dad built
but the same wash tub, yeah, took everybody's bath once a week.
Yeah. The kids, anyway. But then Dad built a bathroom on the side of the house, and we had a real bathtub and stool. We had a two-holer we used to use all the time, but we had a real bathroom.
Now, when you talk about a two-holer, what do you mean by that?
It's about 100 yards from the house. It seemed like a half a mile.
Some of these kids may not know what a two-holer is.
You need to have company. You went to sit on the toilet.
And so you had to go outside to do that little duty?
Oh, you bet. It's cold out there tonight.
me. Do you just tear the page off as you needed it?
That's right. Oh, Tennessee, they were rough. They had a two-holer there, and I went out one day, and they had a pile of corn cobs in the corner, plus to finish up with. Sue, go back.
Oh, we gotta get down to the brass tacks of how life really was. So next time we complain about cleaning our bathroom, we shouldn't complain, right?
No.
So the corn cob pipes and then the Sears robot to finish up. Okay, we've got the picture. Let's talk about water. Let's change the subject. What about water? You told me how you kept it cool.
Well, our drinking water, we had an olla hanging up in the breezeway.
What's an olla?
It's a clay pot that the Indians use, and you wrap it with gunny sack and keep it wet so your water will stay cool. We had no refrigerator, nothing like that. When we started out, we had an ice man to deliver ice. You put a sign in your door, either 25, 75, or 50 or 100 pounds, and you turn it different ways. And so when you drive up, you have 25 out, he'd bring you 25 pounds of ice, put it in an ice box.
Literally, an ice box was for ice then?
Yes, it was an ice box.
What did a typical meal mean for you as a little child?
I don't know. We ate good. I was never hungry. We had a lot of eggs, milk, pancakes.
Okay, tell me what you had for a typical meal.
Oh, we ate a lot of beans and a lot of bread, cornbread, eggs, milk, pork. My mother made her own soap. She was pretty rich. She had a square tub Maytag with a gasoline engine on it. And she had a number 3 wash tub that she had to go out and build a fire hydrant. And she would make her own soap. We'd butcher the pigs, eat everything but the squeal. And render the fat. She'd get her fat off of that and make lye soap. And then chop it up in the big wash tub and dump it in the Maytag washer, wash her clothes. Now she had 5 kids when I was there. She cooked on a wood stove, had an ice box. That's whatever we had. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's about enough of that. So this is along in the 30s, what's during the Depression. We just didn't have anything. We didn't have any money. Nobody had any money, so we didn't worry about it. So we had to farm and raised our own food mainly. My mother would go to gather eggs and take them up to Bash's. Eddie Bash's just had a little grocery store there in Mesa. Now it's a big chain. But she'd take her eggs in and they'd have to candle them, make sure they didn't have chickens in them. So sometimes they stayed out a few days before we picked them up. And she'd trade her eggs for salt, sugar-based flour. And one time was interesting, was we'd go up on Saturday night. Dad'd stand on the street corner and talk, and Mother'd go do her shopping. And I was wandering around there, probably 5 or 6 years old, and stumbled into a theater. I didn't know what it was. I got in there and sat down. It was dark. These horses were running at me, going to run over me. I looked back, and there was a ghost coming in under the doors. And I just sat there, petrified. Finally, Dad, they all got home and counted noses. Found me missing. So he come back to town to find me, and he went to the police chief, his name's Joe Meyer. And he says, "Have you seen Roy?" "Oh, yeah, he went to the theater about 8 o'clock. So they come in here and found me.
So that was your first experience at a movie theater?
Movie theater. Then later on, there's a fellow at the ranch school named Corny. And he had a horse and buggy. His name was Tango. He was about 30 years old. Tango
one of those kind of push mowers?
It was a push mower, hand push mower.
Not by hand on a rider mower?
No, no rider mower, just a real push mower. And whichever one of us kids was old enough, like Herb, he took Herb and then Lewis, and then he started taking me to the show on the Saturday night in that horse and buggy. And we'd always have to get a dime together. He never paid for anything. We had to get our own dime, and we'd ride up to Mesa, tie the horse up, and walk about a block to go into the theater and come back and ride that buggy all the way back home.
What could you buy with the dime?
At the theater.
Well, we got a dollar. Candy bar.
Okay.
For a nickel.
Okay.
I thought you paid the theater.
Huh?
You went to the theater with that, but did you also buy a treat with that?
Oh, no, they didn't have any treats. That was before treats and all that stuff. Nobody had that much money.
Okay, so it was a dime to go to the movie.
Dime to go to the movie. He was adult, so he had to pay a quarter. And at that time, I think a shave and a haircut was 2 bits.
Which is, how much is 2 bits?
25 cents.
Okay. So you went to the movies with this friend on Saturday nights?
Yeah. Going home, I'd be awful sleepy, and I had to come home, and I had to walk about a quarter of a mile to get home. It was kind of scary going across that. Okay, that's enough of that.
Okay, so when you're about 12 years old, you had a great camping trip. What did you do?
Well, I remember one time Dad took me out with him, and he sent me out to get a rabbit. He had me a shotgun. I didn't know the shotgun. I knew he was supposed to point it and shoot it. So I started out pretty quick. I saw a rabbit and I put the shotgun, boom, dumped me on the butt. But I got the rabbit, took it back. Dad was quite a camp cook. He'd cook them everything up. He cooked for those ranch boys when they're traveling. And one time he had moved them to Flagstaff. He had a Model T Ford pickup with about a 6 foot bed in it. These boys would ride horses from Mesa to Flagstaff. Probably camp a couple of nights along the way or three. Dad's job was to go along, bring the feed, feed the boys along the way. And he'd come back, and I think Ruth and Bud and I would come in the driveway and had a big box in the back of that truck. So we run out and see what he had. He opened the box and grinned. 12 kids jumped out of that box.
12 were kids?
Goats. He bought them, I don't know, 2 bits or 50 cents a piece. And so those goats were growing up. Dad had a 27 Chrysler.
1927 Chrysler.
With a canvas top on it. And those goats would jump up on the hood, up over the top, and down the back. One right after the other. It wasn't long, we started eating goats.
Now, when you went on a camping trip with a 12-year-old friend of yours when you were 12?
He was 15.
How long were you gone?
I don't know, several days. Okay. Nobody knew where we were at or what we were doing or nothing. And we got to exploring, of course, like kids do. And found a mine there, and we call it the Roy Dick Mine. This guy's name was Dick Over, Richard Over. He was from New York. We went down there and found a bunch of rattlesnakes and killed them and come home. And about that time we had some neighbors move in north of us. They moved in on Horn Lane and the northwest corner of Horn Lane and Southern Avenue. And I'd heard about them, saw this gal running around up there. Kind of got my attention. So when I went out riding on a horse that day, I went all the way up the Salt River and riding around in the rocks and sand. And was going up a steep hill, and this horse kind of humped with me, and I was on the saddle. It had a steel horn on it. The leather though wore off. And it caught my pants right underneath and ripped them all the way to the belt line.
So in the back, your pants were ripped all the way up?
Up the way to the front.
Okay.
So I checked my toes and they were all right. So I come on home and here's this stranger. strange car in the driveway. Well, no way I'd go in there with a fence like, so I just sneaked in the back door and went to bed, and I peeked through the window, and Mary and her dad and mother were sitting in there, and they were talking. So I just went to bed. I didn't meet anybody.
So this is the first time you had seen Mary in your home?
Yep.
And you were about 12?
About 12, 10 or 12, something like that. And we got to seeing each other pretty regular.
How did you date?
Well, I borrowed Dad's car. I must have been, 13 or 14 then. He had a 34 Chevy. We'd go out on that date, and Mary would go along with us, and we'd always have two or three more boys with us. She liked all the boys.
But she had one special one in mind.
Yeah, she had one special, I guess, because I kind of kept track of that.
So when you saw her, did you feel like she felt about you?
I don't know. How would you ever know?
Okay. But you just said that you kept track of her, so.
Yeah, I kept track of her. Watched her all the time. She's about the only girl to talk to me. So I guess she was in bad shape too. But she had two or three others hanging around. And I found out as I come home from school, I'd go a certain way on my bike. I could pick her up and let her ride for about a half mile or mile on my bike. Then I could hug her a little bit, rub up while she's sitting there, and she'd kind of lean back against me too. So anyway, that got to be a habit. And finally, I went to work for my brother in the summer times. I was driving a tractor for him. It was probably a problem with him or something. And we'd pull up 2 5-bottom disc plows with a TD18 tractor. I guess it was a KO then, Alice Chalmers. And I'd plow for him. They'd get $1.50 an acre to plow, and I'd work 12 hours a day for 25 cents an hour, making lots of money. I'd do 12 hours on a tractor, and then we'd grease it on our own time. And then I'd go see Mary at night. We'd go somewhere, do something all the time. And then one summer, I went to Tucson, worked for 60 cents an hour, building stock tanks.
With the tractor?
With the tractor, working for Les Small, and we called it Small and Rucker, which was Les Small, and Lewis Rucker owned it. I made enough money that summer to buy me a 36 Ford. I could pay $250 for it. So it was about, 3 or 4 years old. But I paid cash for it. I started courting Mary in the 36 Ford. It had a 3-window, back window roll down, twin pipes, and really roar.
Now, the story that I've heard is that you and Mom only had one other boyfriend and girlfriend about your junior year in high school.
Yeah, after that.
Freshman.
She went with a guy named John.
Freshman year in high school. Okay, so after that, you kind of had eyes for each other.
Yeah, all the way through it. Everybody knew us from school. Just figured we were together. And we'd go out, it'd usually be Mary and I and two or three other guys, Lynn Shumway, Walter Kibler.
And Lynn Shumway is still a friend of yours today.
He was our best man at our wedding. Oh, the big exciting part was, any of you know of Encanto Park in Phoenix? Mm-hmm. Anyway, we was out there riding a canoe one time, and she was stretched all out there and looked very inviting. So I leaned over and gave her a kiss, and she kissed me back. Man, I liked to flip.
So that was your first kiss in a Canto Park.
In a canoe.
In a canoe. How old do you think you were then?
I must have been 15, 16.
Wow, so you were friends for a long time first.
Yeah, we were getting old.
There's a story that you tell about going to your 50th reunion, that there was a girl who was kind of a pity. Tell me that story.
Well, it was quite a class of school. It was the farm kids and the city kids. You know, the city kids were kind of uppity, and the farm kids were looked down on. And so we had a class deal there. So at our 50th class reunion, this girl came over talked to us. Her name was Jodine Johnson then. And I don't know, she'd come over and just talk. Mary's there talking to her. So I got the idea. I said, Jodine, we went through school from the first grade to graduating from high school. How come you never would talk to me? Oh, Roy, you had shit on your shoes and you always stunk.
And tell me why that was so. Why was that?
Well, it wasn't so. I take a bath every week, whether I needed it or not.
And what did you do every morning before school?
Well, I had to milk cows, and I only had one pair of shoes. And I managed to do that. You didn't take a shower to go to school.
And you probably didn't have very many pairs of clothes either.
No.
Probably didn't even change them after you did that.
Oh, I'm sure I did. At least got clean clothes. Mother was pretty good about that. Mm-hmm. Well, then in high school, we both took a class. Since we were farm kids and were deprived, well, what did they call that program we were in?
I don't know. I just read it
in the book. Anyway, I went to West State and worked in the parts department as a for free every afternoon. And Mary go to J.C. Penney's, work there. So when we graduated, well, naturally just worked into a job. So I was a clerk there at Hardware, and so was Mary.
How much did you make?
$85 a month. Lots of money. And we got married. We owned our own car, owned our own furniture. We had to rent a house for $10 a month. So we didn't need her income, so I sort of quit, took care of the house, and had my supper ready. And she's done that all of her life. And oh, it's going along there. About that time, my brother called from Flagstaff. He said, Roy, if you can get up here by next Monday, I can have you a job for $140 a week. So I went right in there in the store and bought it. 12 by 14 tent, gasoline stove, some iron skillets, two canvas cots, threw them in the back of the Ford coupe, and away we went. We put our furniture all in storage and went up to Flagstaff. It must have been the summertime we went up there. Set our tent up in the public park there at Belmont. They were building a big ammunition depot there. So the fellow took me out to, he was a good friend of hers, the boss, took me over to the tractor. I never looked at a bulldozer before. He said, take that dozer and smooth that off over there. He watched me about 15 minutes and says, you better come here and let's go muck a while. So he went down, put me on another tractor, and I learned how to run it. We stayed there in that public campground right along the railroad. Mary went to work over at the grocery store for selling the Navajo Indians. And we were just getting along real good. Finally, we bought a 12-foot homemade house trailer. All it had was a bed and a hot plate in it and a table. So Mary didn't have to tie the strings on that tent and take 30 minutes to loosen them up when I come home at 1 o'clock. She had that trailer house. She could put boxes in there so we couldn't get the door open. So she felt real safe after getting out of that tent, because you'd come into that tent at night and she'd be walking around in there with this lantern and see every move she made. Well, after that, well, we just kind of wandered around and finally went to Phoenix and worked, Tucson and worked, down to Sarita. From there up to Kingman. We built an airfield up there, and I went back to work for the fellow I was working for and sat in Belmont. He put me on a big brand new tractor and a big scraper. I was finishing. And we worked there for a while, and Uncle Sam called me to go to service.
What war was going on then?
World War II.
And how old were you when you were called to serve?
19. So I was drafted, and a friend of mine, I'd like to insert this a little bit. was drafted a week before me. He was working in Kingman. He went to Arkansas, got into infantry, and tried to transfer in the Air Force, but never did. And that was April of 42, 43. And he was killed in Anzio Beachhead. He went to North Africa and was in Italy in January of 44. He was killed there. I stepped on a landmine. Well, I went drafted and I went to Louisiana. I went through the same reception center at San Pedro. He went through there a week ahead of me. And I went to Camp Claiborne in Alexandria, Louisiana as a replacement for the 398th Engineers Battalion. So I was in there and then I'd seen this article in the paper that they were looking for pilots. So I applied and about half the company went down to take the physical. And we took the physical and only two of us finished it. Myself and became a friend of ours, Bob Stillman. We finished our physical. In fact, they dilated my eyes. I never had that done to me before. I couldn't see, and I went back to the barracks, and they were all packed up, ready to leave. And I finally got a guy to show me my rifle. I had to look at the serial number, but I couldn't read it, and I tied a string on it. And we left about 1 o'clock in the morning for Arkansas. Went up there and bivouacked in a pup tent and put sandbags on the White River. It was flooding. Was up there for 6 weeks, sleeping on the ground, I guess, in a little pup tent with another guy. And we come back to Louisiana. I had our orders to go to England. And I kept trying to find out what happened to my Air Force application. Nobody knew anything. So I called Mary and she got on a train or airplane, flew to El Paso, got bumped, got on a train. Come all the way to Louisiana. And,
by now you're probably 19 or 20 years old, both of you.
Yeah. Mary's 18, I was 19, I guess. Never been away from home. And she was coming to Louisiana, and I got my orders to report to the Air Force in Wichita Falls, Texas. I left an hour before her train arrived. That was when segregation was full speed ahead, you know. You had black drinking fountains, white drinking fountains, black restroom, white restrooms, and black people everywhere. And Mary gets off of that train, I wasn't there. But I had left a letter with a ticket agent. And, you know, everything was pretty secret then. You couldn't tell what you were doing or where we were going and so forth. Anyway, I wrote her that letter and told her I was going to Wichita Falls, Texas. I think I left at 5:30 and she came in at 6:30. And she finally, they announced her name and she got the letter. And we had a hard time catching up, so I went to Wichita Falls. And she went to YMCA. And stayed overnight. Next morning, got out and got on the train, come to Wichita Falls. Well, she finally located me there, and we couldn't see each other for 2 weeks because I was under quarantine.
Why were you under quarantine?
Well, you had to do that in case you caught some bug or something and pass it to anybody else.
So when she finally found you, she still couldn't see you for two more weeks.
Well, then we could only see her on the weekends. Come down and visit in the evening sometimes.
So what did she do while you were busy doing what you were doing?
Well, she had to make a living. I think I was getting $75 a month. And she got half of it or better. I think I kept $10 or $15, something like that. And she had to go find her a place to live, find her a job, and work to support herself. And I was out on the air base. So we were at Wichita Falls there, and I got inducted, and they sent me to college. About that time, I think she decided to go home and get her car. She had a 41 Chevy then. And I was transferred to Ada, Oklahoma, to East Central State College. And we covered simple math, algebra, geometry, and trigonometry in 10 weeks. And all the rest of the kids were college graduates. They're a little farm boy. Never hardly got out of high school. But Mary moved to Ada, Oklahoma. They rented a house. She got a friend to stay with her. The guy that I'd got out of engineers with, only two of us that finished that. None of the rest of them ever had a chance. So Bob and I were there going to school. And Bob was going to help me through, get in through cadets and so forth. Mary and Elaine lived in the house. I remember they went out and bought a goose for a turkey dinner. They spent 8 hours picking pin feathers out of that goose. There wasn't enough meat on it for two of us, much less four. So it wasn't easy for her either. It was from Ada, Oklahoma. We got transferred to San Antonio.
Now, I had a sister that come into the picture somewhere in here.
That's way back down the line. Anyway, I went to San Antonio.
We aren't ready for that.
Classification. You took a test for 2 days. I remember one question was, how many keys in a piano? Who in the hell would know that? But anyway, somebody told me what it was, so I got that question right.
How many are there?
88. Is there?
I think so.
But anyway, we stayed there at the SAC, they called it San Antonio Aviation Cadet Center. And I classified as a pilot. I either classified as a pilot, navigator, or bombardier. Well, Bob, he didn't make either one of them. He washed out. I had to go back to where he come from.
So you're the only one of your whole group that made it as far as you made it?
Yep. I was the only one out of that company out of probably 100 people that applied. So from San Antonio, they transferred me to Yukon, Oklahoma, where we took pilot training. My instructor had 5 students. He washed them all out but me. So I must have something on the ball with flying. And Mary come on to, this is over a period of 10 weeks. She come to Ada, Oklahoma, and after 10 weeks, she graduated from primary. What of us was left? Went to Garden City, Kansas, and Oklahoma, we flew the PT-19, was a primary trainer. Went to Garden City, Kansas, and flew the BT-13, which was a basic trainer. Stayed there 10 weeks. Mary got a job as a, what were you there?
Grocery store, I think.
No, it was a
meat market or drugstore.
Drugstore. So she got to be a druggist. 10 weeks. Took a 10-week course. Then from there we transferred to Frederick, Oklahoma. And I started flying UC-78s, which was a twin-engine airplane. It was there 10 weeks. We had our uniforms all ready to graduate. And all of a sudden, they shut everything down. As I'm leaving airstrip, they shut them down. In fact, they sent 35,000 cadets back to me because they didn't need any more. They were full up on pilots. But anyway, I was in Frederick and graduated, but I didn't get my wings. They picked out about 60 of us and sent us to Brookfield, Texas. And then I started flying B-25s, and I graduated B-25s, which was very exceptional. And then from there, so Mary come there, we was there 10 weeks.
Shirley was born there.
That was later on.
Okay.
I graduated there in a B-25, and we took a trip to Washington, D.C. to see her folks. And then I reported to Fort Worth, Texas, in B-24s. And we flew B-24s there for 10, 12 weeks. Germans heard I was coming, so they quit.
In other words,
I was flying.
The war was over?
Well, I was training for Germany and flying B-24s. And the Germans heard I was coming, so they quit. So they transferred me to B-29s. They picked out about 50 or 60 of us out of the class and sent us to 29s and went back to San Antonio again. And we trained there in B-29s. I got a pilot, co-pilot, and engineer. We finished that training, and the air base was built for little planes, and we'd get stuck in the asphalt about a foot deep. And then they transferred us to Alamogordo, New Mexico. So Mary Shirley was born there when I was flying B-29s. I remember the morning she was born. Mary was living all by herself, rented room, didn't know anybody. I think her friend was there at that time, took her to the hospital, because I was flying. But that particular day, they put me in a link trainer. And I was in a link trainer, practicing approaches and so forth. I don't know, I had a funny feeling. I raised the hood up, looked out, and I saw a sergeant walking toward me. So I just climbed out of the link trainer. He said that Mary went to the hospital. And that's when Shirley was born, Brooke General Hospital.
So did you get to see her?
Oh yeah, I got to see her that day, I think. So then they transferred me to Alamogordo, New Mexico, from San Antonio. So I had to go off and leave Mary, because I left by the time Shirley was born. In fact, we got to Alamogordo, as they had to drop the experimental bomb. Not drop it, but set it off. That was all the talk of the area. So we got our crew there. We got our 11-man crew and started flying. We get up at 1 o'clock in the morning, go to chow. At 3 o'clock, we go to briefing. By 4:30, we'd hit the flight line and get off the ground at 6. Then we'd fly for 8 hours and come in. Well, the Japs heard it was coming, so they quit.
So you got the Germans to quit and the Japs to quit.
Yeah, they got both to quit. So he said, well, you either go to helicopter school or go home. That's no choice. We're going home. Mary had to come to Alamogordo. I had to go back and get her. I got a milk run. I went AWOL. Got on the airplane, flew a milk run from Alamogordo to Oklahoma City, to San Antonio, to Alamogordo, and so forth. And went 1 weekend, got her, and we drove back to Alamogordo. What did that take us? 2 days?
Probably not.
A drive?
Yeah.
Back to?
To Alamogordo. We drove her to Chevy. She had a good car, so she was in pretty good shape. She had to find a place to stay, and we found a place up in the mountains at Cloudcroft. She stayed there a week, then found a real good house downtown. It was about, 12 by 20. Had a kitchen on one end, a bedroom on the other. Had a hole in the ground outside for an icebox, and a wood stove. Really living it up. I was stationed in Alamogordo, and I had to go back to San Antonio and get Mary and Shirley. Come back to Alamogordo. I think we've already covered that. And we were in Alamogordo and I was flying all the time, and the Japs quit. We sat around there for a month or so. And then they said I could go to helicopter school or go home. I said, I'm going home. So they sent me to Colorado Springs at Lowry Field. Discharged me and I went back to Mesa. I think I'd driven up there and Mary went home. And we rented a house and I worked for Stapley's for the rest of that year. It was December of 45, I think I got discharged. So in September of 46, I decided to go on the GI Bill and go back to school. No particular reason, just go to school. And so I got a job milking 60 cows, night and morning, 7 days a week, and carried 17 units.
And when you milked those cows, did you have a machine or?
It was a, that's when they come out with the milking parlor and had a machine. You never test the milk. It all went from a pipe right into a tank. And it's with Jim Cooper in Mesa. I milk cows there all the winter and went to school. In the summertime, I decided to go back to Tucson, work for Les Small for the summer, and come back in the fall and go back to school. So I did that and moved in with my brother Bud down there, who was working for Les. In a tent. And,
so before you left Mesa, did you get another little bundle of joy?
Apparently. I was doing them pretty regular.
So this was Chuck. So Chuck was born before you moved down there, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Was he little or small or anything?
Small, because this all happened so quick. You know, a year seemed like forever then.
He was only 7 months.
But he came a couple of months early because I think Mom got a little ambitious and wanted to move 100 pounds of grain, right?
That's what she said.
Yep. So now you're moving down to Les Small.
I went back to work for Les Small, and I moved in a tent with Bud. Trying to save her money. I think I was getting $1.25 an hour then. And working 12 hours, 12, 14. And I come home one weekend and Granny had bought a house trailer and moved into it. So her and Shirley and Chuck went back to Tucson with me. We lived out in the desert, following tractors around, building stock tanks and different things.
Didn't you at one time build something over by Aholt somewhere?
Oh yeah, that was later on.
Okay.
I worked all over the southern Arizona.
No water, no bathroom.
So there was no water and no bathroom in this trailer?
No, we just carried water in a barrel, found a mesquite bush for the bathroom.
It's good for the guys. What about the girls?
You can ask Mom about that. They never complain. There's about four of us out there in the little group.
Not just either.
So was Mom designated the cook too?
Yep. She took care of the house and raised the kids. And I supplied.
There you go.
So it come time to go back to school. Well, Les approached me and said, "Roy, I want you to be my foreman." And well, all of his employees had forgotten more about dirt moving than I knew. But I could get along with people. It wasn't long until they all threatened to quit. So Les called me in and told him what was going on. I said, "Well, let me go talk to him." So I went out and spent all day talking to the different employees of Les's. And finally got our differences settled. And I worked with him that way for a couple of years and never got back to school. And somewhere in there, we moved when Karen had come along. I guess we moved back into, rented a house in Tucson. And I stayed in the trailer, coming on weekends. Worked for different people out there, Voices and Clark, and different people doing whatever they wanted done. And soon I had two tractors and then three.
How did you get started in business for yourself?
Okay, well, I approached Les and asked him if he'd lease me a tractor and carry all and Ripper, and he said yes. They're just parked, and he was ranching. So I went and got him and started to work. I paid Les 25% of what I made, but I had to maintain the equipment. All expenses. And I hired his engineer to hustle me work. Fellow named Hank Levitt. And to kind of clarify this a little bit, Les Small and Lewis Rucker were partners at one time. And about long near sometime, well, Les or Lewis went into the Navy and Les bought him out. So then I was just working for Les.
Lewis was your older brother.
Yes. And, Lewis really got me started, I guess, when I leased a tractor from Les. I didn't have any work to do. So Lewis was working down in Eloy on his own. And he had me move down there with a dozer and got me a job for $500. And that's where he got started. So then I had to have a pickup. Rudy Campbell, who graduated from high school, he was running the bank down in Buckeye or somewhere. So I went to see Rudy and told him I need to pick up. He said, well, I'll pick up 21. So I bought an old used Chevy. He paid $600 for it. And he financed it for me, so I paid pickup payments, trailer payments, and tractor payments. And then the house payments.
And you're under 30. Because I was born when you were 30, so you're probably 26, 27 years old. You had three kids, and you were managing your own business.
And along after I borrowed this money to get in business, Uncle Sam called me. Want me to go to Korea as a B-29 pilot. Well, I borrowed all this money and had all this work going, and if I had quit it all, I'd lost everything. So I had a friend out there as a rancher and I worked for named Joe Mueller, and he was a colonel in charge of 303rd Bomb Group in Davis-Monthan. So I went out there to see him one night. I told him about I had my orders to report to Long Beach the next morning. What would he advise? I didn't want to go, and he looked at my papers and said, well, you got to go. He says, how many dependents do you have? I said, three. Well, what about your wife? Oh. He says, that's an automatic deferment. So you take your marriage license and your three birth certificates with you in the morning. And go to San Pedro. So I went over to San Pedro to go into processing, to go into the service again, because I was in a reserve. You had to sign up for 5-year reserve when you got out. So I started through the processing, and here's a guy sitting on a bench, been a captain, a fighter pilot, had been delivering papers. He went back in the service, but he couldn't pass the physical. Well, I just went there and passed the physical like that. And got to the end of the line, like, this master sergeant was checking my papers, and he says, well, you're the only 6th B-29 pilot, and that's what we're looking for. And I said, well, I don't want to go. He said, what do you mean? So I pulled out the marriage license and three birth certificates. He says, oh, you'll have to see General so-and-so. So I got into the general, and he'd give me a pep talk about what the future was in the Air Force and everything. I said, no. So I'll go home. That's another big change in her life, because if I went back to service, we'd probably been there from then on.
So you got deferred from there. So now you're headed back to Tucson. By now you have a little house. You have three little children.
I'm growing business.
And how did you get started, the money that your gentleman loaned you?
Jimmy Douglas, I paid less off and made payments to the bank from then on. So I made payments the rest of my life. Get one tractor paid for and I buy another one. Granny was very supportive and she lived very frugally. I think we lived comfortable, but we didn't have a lot of money to blow. Because if I had any extra, I bought some more equipment.
But every time you had a dollar, you bought more equipment.
But anyway, things, you know, and every dollar I'd get, it'd be gone. And I said, well, wait a minute, we've got to do something here different. So I went down to the bank and I said, now pull out a $100 war bond every month out of my checking account. Says there's any money in there, I spend it for equipment. Well, this went on for 10 to 15 years, I guess. And I was working one day and I saw an ad about a GI Bill for farmland in Yuma, Arizona. So I checked it out and applied for it. Well, about 6 months, I got a letter. It says, you were unsuccessful in Yuma. Are you interested in Coachella Valley? I don't know where Coachella Valley was. I just checked yes and sent it back. Another 6 months, I was working up in Aralipa Canyon. I had a telephone to pick up. Mary called me, got a letter that we won a drawing in Coachella Valley. I was just find out where it's at and go. So we drove to Indio and they had this tour. It took about 40 or 50 people, taking, showing them the different farm sites. And I was sitting there, this showing us one, I think it was there about where Harlan Gray was. Mary was back there and she was looking at it. The guy picked up some sand and said, I see all the clay in the soil. Mary said, well, we got better soil than that and our sand washes. She got a raise out of it. So anyway, we talked to him, talked it over, and she decided she had to live there 7 months out of a year. I had to live on it 3 years. 2 years I got credit for military service. We had to live on it 7 months. That meant a year. So moved her over there.
But before we moved over there, Bruce had arrived.
Oh,
we forgot Bruce.
He was 18 months old then.
So you have 5 children now.
Yep. And moved her out in the middle of the desert. Pregnant and barefooted.
That's where the old expression comes from, huh?
It was true.
We rented an old house down there by